Hey.
Hey guys, this is Michael Duke from Party Down South Tee. Thanks for listening to Bring Me Your Torch with Jesse and Elaine.
Welcome to another episode of Bring Me Your Torch. I'm Jesse.
And I'm Elaine.
And today's episode of Bring Me Your Torch is brought to you by Loot Crate. Save 10% on any new subscription by going to trylootcrate.com/torch. Once you're there, enter promo code BRIDGE10 for 10% off. So, Lance, been a crazy evening, hasn't it?
Crazy doesn't even really sum it up, but yeah, for sure.
We've had a crazy weekend, too, though. We hung out in New York together. And, you know, tonight in Big Brother, we saw Zingbot and made me think of Elaine. It was good seeing you this weekend. And the best part was leaving. Zing.
I love it. No, Zingbot's the best.
We hung out across the river in Jersey City for a little bit. You guys were up there for a wedding. So we kind of went to some bar at like 2 o'clock in the morning. Then we got food at some diner at like 2:30 in the morning. And then Ron and I argued about politics till like
4 a.m.
I knew it was time to go to sleep because in the middle of arguing, I just hear Ron snoring. And then I get up at like 10 o'clock and you're like, why are you up so early? I'm like, well, it's 10 o'clock. I'm leaving. I'm the bus in like 4 hours.
And then we went over to the World Trade Center and had lunch and in the food court there in the mall. And we had a nice walk around there. And it was so hot. It was like 110 degrees in New York City last weekend.
You know, I have the windows open. I'm in Connecticut, to listeners who don't know that. And all day it was beautiful out. And I swear now we're recording, it's 9:45 at night. It's humid again. And I'm sitting here sweating. I thought maybe I was going to enjoy a nice night with the windows open and a breeze coming through. No, back to being humid. Oh, boy.
No.
You know, in 6 months from now, I'll be complaining it's too cold. It's like we're never having.
I agree. And in Texas, it's been raining for the entire week. And it's like 75 degrees, which is very untimely for Texas. It's very like 110 degrees here usually in August. So.
Well, and, you know, and this weekend I'm going to Terrific Con up at the Mohegan Sun Casino. I'm going to be there, you know, buy a bunch of dorky comic books and stuff. But while I'm there, they're having an after party. And we're going to see our friends Ming Chen and Rob Bruce. We hung out with them at
AustinCon.
You know? So, and Rob retweeted us like, yeah. And he added Kevin Smith and he's going to be there too. So I don't know. Maybe he's going to come to the after show. Who knows?
Definitely. Maybe we can give him some tea for t-shirts.
And I'm only going to be there till about 10 o'clock or 10:30, because then I have to leave because the Mohegan Sun Casino is in Uncasville. It's in the middle of nowhere. I got to come back and go to Hartford, go to a bar club thing at 11 o'clock at night because Wes from The Challenge is going to be hanging out. And, you know, I used to be out to all hours of the night. But, man, going to Hartford with all these little, like, 25-year-olds running around now at, like, 11:30. Oh, it's going to be late, but – I tweeted bananas from my own personal account. Not bananas, Wes from my own personal account.
Oh, do not do that. Ooh.
Well, I said I wanted to trash talk a little with bananas, about bananas. And he goes, only a little? Ha, ha, ha. So I'm ready to get this going. At least get a picture with him. You know, maybe slip him a business card and tell him to come on the show.
I think that could work. I mean, Wes isn't my favorite person, but I think a lot of people like him. And so I think...
We've discussed this. We're sellouts.
We change our opinions immediately. We love Wes.
Wes. There you go. I actually kind of like Wes, but you love Wes now. God, you're trying to ruin everything.
His honesty with how he kind of sided with bananas on his decision to take the entire amount.
You like redheaded pale men, right?
Just
say yes. Just say yes. Before we get into our shows this week, I want to give a little shout out to our girl Kayla from Real World Go Big or Go Home. She posted a picture today wearing a Bring Me Your Torch tank top. What?
Ow, ow, ow.
She is our favorite, I guess, member of the MTV family. So it's good to have her rocking our logo on Twitter and stuff. And, you know, if you're following us and listening to us, I'm sure you're following her. But if not, get it over there. Her Twitter handle is at Kayla. That's K-A-I-L-A-H underscore Casillas. That's K-A-S. K-A-S. That's C-A-S-I-L-L-A-S. Follow her. She's awesome. She's hot. She's beautiful. She's fun. She's a girl, right?
She's amazing, and she's real. She's down to earth, and hopefully at some point we'll see her on The Challenge.
God's willing, because the people they had in the last challenge, about a quarter of them didn't deserve to be there. So anyways, let's go and talk about a couple of the shows, a couple of things coming up. You know, 90 Day Fiancé is going to be debuting season 4 in September, and they put out the trailer. And I want to run by this trailer bit by bit, just, you know, piece by piece with you, get your thoughts. So there are a lot of classic things in these trailers that, you know, are always a mess. People on this season, like always, getting engaged before they actually meet them in person. Is that ever a good idea?
No.
You should probably meet the person you're going to marry before you get engaged to them. Just, you know, a little fact. There are people not knowing.
Just a little fact. People... I just want to sprinkle that in there. You might want to meet them before you marry them.
There are people who are marrying other people, but they don't know where their countries are. Like, some person's like, where's Morocco? If you don't know where the country is that your fiance is coming from, maybe buy a map. Go to Google Maps.
Hold on. So did they not talk to them before they...
No, it's like they talk to them. It's like if you were like, I'm from France, and I'm like, I don't even know where France is. If you were going to marry someone from a country, wouldn't you make Wikipedia the country or something and find out where
France
it is?
France is like, it's like obvious where France is, right? But if you're like talking about like Tunisia, you're like, is that like Africa or is that Middle East? But it's like North.
Wouldn't
Africa,
you look it up? Like, if you were going to marry somebody from this country...
Google that go, shit.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hey, one of the women on the show, she's marrying a guy who originally was catfishing her. FYI, that's a warning sign, and you probably weren't the only person he was catfishing, and now you're marrying. It's like if you watched Catfish and a guy thought he was dating a supermodel, and it turns out it was like some frumpy girl, and they fell in love. It's like, no, it's not how it works.
Wait, so she realized, or production realized, that he was catfishing her, but she still went through with the marriage? But how do you, like, are you normal if you're marrying somebody who's catfishing you? Is that okay? Like, I don't get it.
Yeah, you know, it means you're lonely because this guy was the first conversation you had with this guy was a lie.
You ended up marrying?
Yes. Yes. It was like, hi, I'm Justin Bieber. Let's have an online relationship. And you said, okay. And then it turns out I'm Jesse. And you go, that's okay. I'll still marry you. Like, that's weird. That's not normal.
I feel like that's exactly what all of these relationships are. It's one big catfish.
Yeah, but it's kind of like how they say, you know, a true friend stabs you in the front. Most of these people are being like, this is what I look like. You know, I'm being obvious. You're just being stupid. This guy was actually lying to her.
All right. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing the season. And
one guy said he spent $70,000 on this girl since they've had a relationship. And they show her like, during the season, like erasing his phone and like breaking things.
So I want to know the demographic of these people, and I want to know the age, because I think...
Weirdos, that's their demographic, I think.
I want to know where they're from, and I want to know how old they are relative to each other. I think that matters.
I mean, here's the main thing I take away from this, and it's going to sound mean, but it's not being mean. It's being factual. All of the foreigners are much more attractive than their American counterparts. Like if you know, Gisele Bündchen was messaging me, hey, I live in Germany, or Brazil, where the hell she's from, and you want to come.
So you would sign up for the Olympics and try to get into, like, yeah. Michael Phelps, like, swim team, American swim team.
Yeah, I'm your swim
team. I need my road to Rio. No. Where's Gisele?
Super, super, super hot people, or just really, really good-looking people, don't normally go with, like, you know, normal, like less than normal looking people. It sounds mean, but you know what I'm saying? Like, it's just not how it goes.
You know,
obviously, you want to come to America.
You know who would like definitely corroborate this? I feel like if we got him on the podcast, and we will have him on the podcast this season coming up, Fernando. Fernando would like definitely be like, Carolina is like God and she's amazing and she's like better looking than everyone. Because personally, I think Carolina's amazing and she's better looking than everyone. But he would definitely be able to corroborate your story and say that, yeah, a lot of the Americans, quote unquote Americans, they're not quite as good looking as all their international.
So you're asking Fernando to corroborate that he's not good looking? Is that what you're trying to say? I'm confused.
No. He will be the first to say, I'm not as good looking as Carolina and all the other kind of, you know, the foreigners who come and marry the Americans. Yeah, like Carolina's amazing. He's not as hot. I'm sure he can vouch for that.
You know, if it seems too good to be true, it probably is. And that's the kind of situation in these things.
Oh
my God.
I totally agree with that, though. Because he lucked out, man. He lucked out.
Yeah. And what percentage of these people do? I mean, look at our friends, Danielle and Muhammad. They have some other shows coming out, I think, in September, too. And It's not going to be a pretty show.
Well, we'll have some updates on Danielle and Muhammad. I've been in touch with Danielle, and we can talk about that close to the time when their show airs. And, you know, we'll have some new happenings for you regarding their relationship.
All right, sweet. So we'll do a special 90 Day Fiancé preview pod when we get closer and we have their bios and everything. So on to Big Brother. So we had a double eviction last week. Zakiya went home. Bridget was evicted. Mish somehow stayed. Were you surprised? Did you think Mish was going to leave? Especially after she just called out people before the vote.
And I love how she sobbed uncontrollably after she called out Nicole and Polly. I was very surprised. Almost quite as surprised as the face that she had when they realized that Zakiya was going home. But yeah, I thought Polly would have had his way in that eviction, but I guess he didn't. I guess he's not as powerful as he thought he was.
Well, tonight on Big Brother, when Zingbot showed up, he goes, "We have a new Big Brother baby. She sleeps all day, cries all night, and is always throwing up." Michelle, zing!
Did she really throw up?
I don't know. I think she's always getting sick or something. I don't know. But it was pretty.
Oh, she's such a Big Brother fan. I hate her game. Is just, somebody called it out. I can't remember who it was. Her game's so based on like jealousy, and I don't know. Like there's something going on with Meech that I just can't pinpoint.
And speaking of Zakiya going home, you know, another kind of scummy move, in my opinion, from Paulie. He basically admitted that he banged her like 5 times, and then she like wanted to kiss him afterwards. He's like, "No, we're just cuddling."
Wait, what? No. Wait, hold on, what?
Yeah, I think he was saying how like he like banged her once, and it was like one pump the first time, and then like 2 pumps the second time from like behind, and he did it so no one could tell they were doing it or something. It was kind of gross.
Paul,
like, you know,
wait, Paulie said that he banged Zakiya a couple times.
Yeah.
And then he did it kind of nonchalantly under the cover,
like, you know,
so that the
cameras people couldn't tell.
Yeah. That they were just like quote unquote cuddling.
Yeah, and then she like wanted to give him a kiss afterwards, and he's like, "No, we're just cuddling. We're not. It would be weird to kiss or something."
Wow. So they didn't use a condom.
Oh well, that's why we need a little more stupid Kelly Fiori's running around. I mean, Paulie had a complete meltdown this week.
I do want to say I want to call him. We're not calling him Paulie Fiori. We're going to call him the Fuhrer. Because. No,
Fuhrer. Cal Fuhrer.
The Fuhrer. He was totally the Fuhrer in the house for weeks on end. And now it's coming to an end.
Okay. And Paulie had a meltdown this week. First he yelled at Natalie, because Natalie was talking about his relationship with Zakiya and kind of warning Zakiya, you know, maybe you want to stay clear of him. And he said something like, "You're as fake as those things on your chest." And, you know, that's not cool. You can't do that. And then Victor won HOH and put Paulie up because the whole house is really tired of it. And he's crying and he's whining and he doesn't want to go to jury house. Oh, stop crying, a little bitch.
Wow.
Man up.
I can't believe he's trying to tell everyone that he doesn't want to go to jury house.
You know, he'll go because they probably won't pay him if he doesn't. He's just being a little bait.
Who really gives a crap if he doesn't go to the jury house?
Well, people need his vote one way or the other.
No, they don't.
And just despite him. Yes, you do. What are you talking about? You need the number of votes. You need an odd number of votes for the final two people.
Paulie thinks he's more valuable than he actually is. He's so irreplaceable.
What do you say? What are you talking about? He's irreplaceable?
No, he's replaceable. Like, he's just a warm body. I think that anyone could step into his place and vote or not vote. Like, he doesn't, no one needs to change their entire game because Paulie doesn't want to go to the jury and he's going to leave.
It doesn't matter. He's going to have the round trip pass. You know, they've rigged it so that he'll come back in. So he'll somehow win HOH, and then it'll be a whole thing. But the America's Care package is that the person that America picks will be the co-head of household.
Have we found out that yet?
No, I think people online are really pushing for Victor so he can screw it up if Paulie wins somehow.
Wait, co-HOH? What does co-HOH get?
I think it means like one person nominates one person, the other nominates another.
Oh.
Before we move on, I want to take a second and talk about Loot Crate for a moment.
Okay.
You know, I mentioned earlier that I'm going to be going to Trificon this weekend at Mohegan Sun. And, you know, I'll buy a few comic books. I'll buy like a t-shirt. I'll get some art. A bunch of geeky stuff. Well, Loot Crate is basically a Trificon, only it ships you at your door once a month. I mean, it's pretty cool. You get a monthly box of mystery geeky goodies, you know, with shirts, collectibles, gadgets, art, just cool stuff. And you get it all for $20, less than $20, actually. That's a good price, right?
Yeah.
And if you don't even want to pay that less than $20 fee, you can save 10% by going to trylootcrate.com/torch and you enter promo code BRIDGE10. It's BRIDGE10. And you'll save 10% off your first new subscription. So again, go to trylootcrate.com/torch and use promo code BRIDGE10 for 10% off.
An amazing deal.
Amazing. So on to Bachelor in Paradise. Are you caught up with Bachelor in Paradise?
Yeah.
So what the friggin' hell is going on with Evan? What was that? Was that like a fake medical emergency he did?
I feel like everything Evan does, I think Evan's just oblivious. He just goes about his life and he just does things and he wakes up and he's like, what happened?
So a little background on this. So Evan and Carly kind of had a thing. She kicked him to the curb and basically said he was disgusting. Kissing him was like gross and disgusting. But she gave him a rose anyways because there was really no other option. And she was still kind of flirty with him afterwards. Like, she goes back and forth with him. Yeah. And after one night of drinking with her and Daniel and what was it like? Sarah, who the hell is the other girl? I can't remember her name. Anyways, he goes to sleep or something. And then all of a sudden you see a producer like shaking him awake. Evan, wake up. Wake up. And he won't wake up. And they rush in the medical team and they're putting things, you know, buttons on them and finger things
but
on them.
Everybody passes out when they're drunk. And how do they just know to wake Evan up?
That's exactly it. So why was there a producer? Like, how would you know the difference between him having some medical issue other than just sleeping? Because the next thing you know, Carly's in the room asking if he's okay. And then he basically is like smiling and makes her make out with him. Like, it was,
you know,
it was really weird.
Production did a really bad job because they didn't really show him pounding drinks or playing drinking games or doing any of that stuff.
I think Evan's a mad genius. I think he just like concocted this entire medical emergency thing just so that Carly would feel bad for him and then like him. And she kind of likes him again now. It's so weird. She talks such smack about him. And then she's like, he's weird. And I kind of like weird. And then she's making out
with
him.
I like Evan a lot.
Like, there's something sweet about him and also something very creepy about him. I can't kind of tell which is the real Evan. I don't know. It's just, it's a whole bizarre thing.
So can you really blame it?
Hey, you know what? He helps men all over the world get it up, and yeah, good for him. Like, he's doing God's work, I suppose, for the men 60 and above or 40 and above. I don't know.
I bet it's 20s and 30s too. Wouldn't put it past them.
I knew a kid in high school took one just for shits and giggles, and and how gross is Josh Murray's grunting? Like, I think you're a girl, so maybe you feel differently. I feel the guy is just like gross all around.
What do you mean? I don't get it. What's this grunting stuff?
So when he's making out with Amanda,
does
first
he comes
and steals Nick's girl.
I feel like I watch him a lot. Was he grunting?
This is what it's like. This is my impression of him making out with her.
Maybe that's production. Mm-hmm. Maybe they put a little.
No. It's his grunt. And then he's eating pizza when she's Evan
that's
comes
gross.
Along. Tries,
yeah, the
and
pizza
he's like,
eating and then making out. It's like, do I
pizza.
Really? Yeah.
Normal people, and then the dude sweats.
Here, why don't we try it? Do it.
Laying there.
Everybody.
Wait,
cheese. He likes cheese straight up.
I think we just disturbed and disgusted our listeners. I'm sorry for that, but I just don't like the dude. He seems and he's like, "Oh, Andy Dorfman's book is all a bunch of lies." And Nick's like,
"The book. What do you think was? I was just. What do you think?
I think it said he's emotionally abusive."
Well, the guy could pound you. So was he physically abusive?
Yeah, she just said that he was like very emotionally abusive and kind of, you know, telling her what she can and can't do and just anything, you know, being, you know, whatever. So, and Nick was in the book too. And Nick said basically anything that was written about him, there was some basis in truth. So he thinks there's some truth about what they were saying about him too. So I don't know. And then Kayla comes, and I like Kayla a lot I mean, relatively speaking, a bunch of all these douchebags. And then Jared, who is basically attached to one of the twins, kicked the twin to the curb because everybody wanted Kayla. And I love it because next week it looks like Kayla might just kick him to the curb.
Kayla wants all the drama that's coming with what's her face that's obsessed over
Ashley I.
Over Jared. I don't think she wants all that.
Apparently, Kayla and Ashley I are friends outside of the house. And Ashley was like, if you go, please don't go after Jared. And Kayla's like, okay. And then she changed her mind when she got there.
Jared's not that great, though. So I don't understand why people are even fighting over him. He's a nice guy, but to be honest, I'd walk away from that if it was hurting my friend Ashley.
Jared is definitely the kind of guy who is like acting differently to Ashley off air and probably leading her on and stuff.
Sorry, I was grunting like Josh.
That was so disturbing. But, you know, he's probably like, yeah, you know, cuddling with her and stuff off the air. Yeah. And then he gets on there and she's like, oh, she's nuts. She's obsessed with me.
Yeah, I agree. But she does have some emotional issues. She cries at the, she's like, I only want to cry three times. Chris Harrison's like, three times a day.
And she's talking to like a parrot and stuff. They I love how like, they make these edits so that it makes these people really look even crazier. You know, a couple of seasons ago, they had one of the girls talking to a raccoon.
But no, I think that chick was really crazy. I don't think Ashley I is that crazy.
You know, yeah, she's an emotional, but I feel as if I was dating her. If she liked me and I liked her, there wouldn't be any emotional stuff. It would just be like, oh, good, we're both happy together. It's only when you come on these shows and, oh, I met you 5 minutes ago. Now we're making out and now we're basically married.
Yeah, but grass is always greener. There's always somebody who's nipping at your heels and
Jack like, Frost.
Yeah, like Jack Frost nipping. No, there's always somebody who wants you, you don't want, and you want somebody else. So it's just one big love triangle in paradise.
A lot of times I feel like it's a love square, or a love love polygram, or octagon, or
menage a trois, monsieur.
It's just people getting drunk and then making out with each other and then yelling at each other. And that's why I actually really like this show.
With this show, though, this season, aren't there going to be like one or two weddings or proposals at least?
Well, there are a couple of these people, I won't say who, that have been confirmed to be together still after the show. Yeah, TMZ ruined one for me. You could see it easily online. I think Reality Steve.
Who is it?
I'm not going to say.
You're not going to say?
No, I want you to watch the show and enjoy it.
All right. Well, maybe next. Maybe we get closer to the end.
Again, if you really want to find out, just Google it. It's not hard to find. Go to Reality Steve's website. He has all that stuff on there.
Okay.
All right. So the last show we're going to talk about is the season 4 finale of Are You the One? And they have 10 perfect matches. What a coincidence. I kind of feel like this is rigged.
Hold on. So I only saw season 3 and this season 4. So the season 1 and 2, let's talk about, did they also get all perfect matches on the final try?
Yep, every single time it happens. And just look, they had like zero new ones 2 weeks ago, but three things ago, you know, three ceremonies ago.
They had a
ago.
Blackout.
Yeah, and then they got 6 total, the second to last one, and then suddenly they get them all. It just seemed too convenient.
So did they all have a blackout in all seasons before this?
Last season was the first time there was ever a blackout. At least last season was the only time they ever lost money, I believe, for the blackout.
Oh, okay.
So they're getting worse and worse.
They're
basically getting like $37,000 each before taxes. So it's a nice chunk of change, but it's like nothing. You know, they're like, $1 million? Yeah, split 20 ways.
Yeah.
Dumbs. You know, you get $37 and probably like chlamydia or something.
You black out and you don't have health insurance. So you're definitely.
Obviously, we're fans of Kaylin. My girl I was most attracted to was Tori on that show. I kind of dug that.
She's
that
a blonde haired chick.
Yeah,
I like her.
She just seemed fun, kind of laid back and normal and stuff. I enjoyed the show. There were some people, know what to see on the challenge? John. He's so angry all the time. I feel as though he would go and just get his butt kicked immediately on the
guy
challenge.
That was going after Julia the entire time and was upset.
Yeah, like punching walls and stuff.
I think there would be a lot of good people that would come out of that season that would go on the challenge.
Many. I feel as though you could only maybe put no more than 4 on a show. When you start putting too many in there, people who don't watch Are You the One are like, what the hell am I looking at? Who are these people?
Well, then maybe they should watch Are You the One because it's a good show.
Maybe they should.
I would be watching it every season. I will have to say
I do like the host. He's kind of the straight guy there. I think he's like in on the joke.
I have to say he might be one of the worst hosts that I've ever seen on any
what?
Show. So Jesus I don't Christ. Like him at all because he doesn't really know how to interact with everybody on the show. And he doesn't keep the flow of the show going very well. He never really seems to know what to say.
I hope he's not following us on Twitter. I think he likes something we said once. If you are, please stay with us. If you come on our
show,
stay
with us. I just think he needs to kind of firm it up a little bit when it comes to kind of hosting shows. He needs to look at Julie Chen. He needs to look at TJ Lavin. He needs to look at Chris Harrison and how they interact with the cast.
Well, Julie Chen is sleeping with the boss. So,
who would be?
Yeah. I am a big fan of Les Moonves.
So you think Are You the One's rigged?
I don't know. Like, if it was rigged, it doesn't mean the contestants know it's rigged, but it just seems too... What are the chances that it happens in the last episode every single time?
Yeah, I think you're right. But you have to look back at the first two seasons.
Yeah, well...
Did they think they were giving them too much money, and that's why they didn't get it?
I don't know. Well, we'll just wait. If it happens in the last episode next season, I can't help but say it's rigged. All right. Before we go, you watching the Olympics?
Of course.
You loving the Olympics?
Oh, yeah. I'm all about some Usain Bolt. Let's be serious.
I'm ready for it to be over. It's fine. But, you know, there's only so much I can really care about, like diving and stuff and swimming.
You don't like freaking Michael Phelps, who's from Baltimore, Maryland, shot out?
Yeah. I mean, he's fine. But it's like we talk about this in New York that – the Olympics are like 2 weeks. It's on every 4 years. So I pretty much care about swimming 1% of my life. Do I really care about it? No.
All right.
Well, guy swims fast.
I think there's a lot of people that'll feel the same way, but I kind of like it. I like pop culture. I like all things relevant right now, right here. Get into it, man.
Well, before we go, I want to say one last quick thing, too. I was very sad this weekend. I don't think you ever watched the show, so you'll probably wonder who the hell I'm talking about. But longtime political host, television show host, John McLaughlin died yesterday. He had a show that's on for 32 years. He used to be like, at the end of the show, going, bye bye. And he used to say, he's been around for a while. He's a political staple in Washington, D.C. And made me very sad that he died. He was like 89, so he's old. But I don't know what I'm going to do on Sunday mornings not to watch it anymore.
What show was it?
It's called the McLaughlin Group. There's like four people, usually like a Democrat, Republican, and then a couple independent people. And he would start off the show by saying things like, on a scale of 1 to 10, with 1 being absolute zero probability and 10 meaning complete metaphysical certitude, what are the chances that you're going to be listening to Bring Your Torch? Pat Buchanan, I ask you. And they would kind of go back and forth. There was actually in the 80s a very famous Saturday Night Live skit where Dana Carvey played him. You can probably find that. But, He was apparently a Jesuit priest. Then he was a Nixon speechwriter or something. Then he became a television host. But he was like one of those, you know, it's one of those shows on PBS. And I'm a political nerd as opposed to just being a regular nerd. So I watched all that stuff. So I was kind of sad when he died.
I'm sorry. Well, but, rest in peace.
89's a good run, right?
Oh, well, yeah.
So, all right. That's it. End on a downer. That's what we do best around here. End in the show on a downer. So when you're... done watching that Saturday Night Live skit about John McLaughlin.
Definitely
you can go to our website. Go to that website, www.bringmeyourtorch.com. But where else can you go?
Facebook.com/bringmeyourtorch or Twitter.com/bringmeyourtorch without the H.
No H.
And iHeartRadio.
And AHA Radio, apparently. You can go to iTunes. You can leave us 5 stars and a great review. You can go to YouTube. You can go to Blueberry. You can go to Stitcher if you have a Droid. Just Google Bring Me Your Torch to find us anywhere you need to go. And then when you're done with that, you can just remember that you may have come here as a stranger, but you're leaving as a friend. We'll see you next time on Bring Me Your Torch.
Bye.